Today we are going to see the topic distributed database under unit 5. So you all know what is database. So distributed database means a single database is distributed under multiple locations, then it is a distributed database. So this is a formal definition for distributed database. A single logical database is located under multiple locations through data communications. That is what distributed databases. So data communications means through network you can connect your database under multiple locations. So here I am giving an animated representation of a distributed database. A single database has been shown here. Here the single database distributed over multiple locations and it has been connected to a centralized database which is through network, and each and every individual multiple locations of database is connected through again network. So this is what distributed databases. So why we are going for distributed databases? We can improve the performance and scalability rather than a centralized database. If you have a centralized database, so even if you are going to use multiple users, the multiple users will access the same centralized database at a time, might be the load or performance will get decreased if you are using centralized database. If you are going to work on distributed database, the performance might get improved as the database are stored in different locations. So this is why we are going for distributed database. So scalability and performance will get improved through throughput and data size. Even if you increase the size of your data, the performance will not be degraded and also the throughput will be maintained. Next, resilience to failures means if you are going to handle the failures, how you are going to handle the failures, what is the capacity to recover from the failures, that is what the resilience meaning. So resilience to failures means like the capacity to recover from the failures. If you're going to have a single database and if you're going to have a multiple database, your scalability and performance will get improved as you're going to store it in multiple locations. If you're going to have a database failure, it will be failed only in one location rather than in the rest of the locations. The database will be maintaining properly, so you will not lose the whole data in your database. So this is how you will represent your distributed database. So it is like a client server architecture. Here you will have a user interaction and your database that can be connected through network. So how your data will be distributed? So you all understood what is distributed database and why we need to distribute your database, because you need to improve your performance and scalability, which is very essential for database, because many thousands of people will be accessing the same database, which might reduce your performance. That is why we are moving for distributed database. So this is what the reasons and what is distributed database. Now we need to know how to distribute the database. What all the data is to be stored in one location and what are the data to be stored in the next different locations. That can be distributed under two methods. One is hash partitioning, the other one is range partitioning. So what is hash partitioning means? You need to calculate the hash function to partition your database. For example, you need to find out the hash value. Based on the hash value, the data in your database will get separated into different locations so that a single database which has been distributed equally among different locations. That is what hash partitioning. If you are going to go with the range partitioning, you are going to have the range values. For example, you are going to have your key as age. If it is less than 50, the less than 50 data will be stored in one location and greater than 50 data will be stored in the other location. Likewise, you can have the range values to be stored in different locations. That is how you can distribute your data. This is the physical representation of how it is being stored under different locations. So here you have 8 records. So these 8 records will be equally splitted and that can be stored in different locations without any conditions. Like I have not used any conditions like hash partitioning or range partitioning. Just like that, as I have 8 records that has been splitted into 4 multiple locations. See, here it has been stored under four locations. That is why I have named it as server 1, 2, 3, 4. All these four servers have equal number of records. Next, the features we have in a distributed database is data fragmentation, replication, and allocation. So how the data will be distributed and how it can be stored. That is what the features over here. Here, fragmentation, data replication, and data allocation. So what is fragmentation means? It is the normal meaning of fragment. So it is like breaking the database into small fragments, and that the small fragments will be stored in your various sites of your database. Data replication means your data will be replicated more than one location. That is for data replication. And data allocation means the data will get allocated in particular site in a distributed system. We are going to see all these three features in detail. First is fragmentation. So under fragmentation, we have three types of fragmentation. One is horizontal, one is vertical, and the other one is hybrid. Hybrid is a combination of both horizontal and vertical fragmentation. So now we are going to see only about horizontal vertical fragmentation. So you can understand what is hybrid fragmentation after knowing about horizontal and vertical. So horizontal fragmentation is also called as partitioning, because fragmentation is just like that you are going to break up your database into multiple records that can be stored in different locations. That is why I'm naming it as either horizontal fragmentation or horizontal partitioning. Both are same. So in horizontal fragmentation, you are going to divide your database into different rows of data. Like if you are going to have 100 records, 20 records will be stored in 5 different sites. That is what the meaning of horizontal partitioning. It is going to partition the rows of a table at different sites. So it is going to divide or break your table in horizontal manner. So if you have 10 attributes, all 10 attributes will be stored in one location, provided that it will store only the limited number of records. That is for different rows of a table at different sites. For example, if I have 100 records, 20 records will be stored in different 5 locations. And the advantage is like the data can be stored close to it where it has to be used. For example, if I need 20 records, those 20 records will be stored in my location, which is very efficient to retrieve my data because it is stored under my local site. So wherever the particular record is to be needed or to be accessed, you can store the data close to you so that it is very efficient for accessing and retrieving your data. Next, you will have a better performance. Next, only your relevant data will be available, so you don't need to search more, so you have a more secure data. Next, you are going to perform union, because as you are going to store the number of records in different locations, it is easy to use union operations to combine all the operations to form a centralized database. You have a disadvantage, like as it is being accessed across multiple locations, you might have the access speed which is less when compared to a normal access speed. And you cannot have the duplications or replications. Because of that, if you get failure, then you cannot get back your data. Because of that, this horizontal partitioning has certain disadvantages. And next is about vertical fragmentation or vertical partitioning. So in vertical partitioning, even here you are going to partition your database, but it is in vertical manner. That means different columns will be stored in different locations. For example, if I'm going to have 10 attributes or 10 columns, two attributes will be stored in 5 different locations. That is what different columns will be at different sites. So the advantage and disadvantages of the vertical partitioning and horizontal partitioning are same, but only it requires you, instead of union, it requires join operation, because it is going to combine columns only to get the whole original database. Then hybrid, as I told you, it is a combination of both horizontal and vertical. Next is about data replication. So under data replication, you have three types. One is fully replicated, next is no replication, and next is partial replication. So fully replicated distributed database means the whole distributed database will be replicated. so that even if you have a failure in one of your database, it can be recovered back with the help of replication. Next is no replication means you will not have any replication or duplication of your database. Partial replication means you will have the partial amount of data will be replicated so that only the partial amount of data can be recovered from your distributed database. Next is about data allocation. So data allocation is also called as data distribution. So here you are going to choose for which site the data, these data should be allocated. So this can be done with the help of data allocation. So this and data allocation depends upon the performance and availability of your system. And next is you need to know about your types of transaction. Under what type of transaction your data should be allocated. All these should be known for your distributed database. Next is about types of distributed database. You have here you have two types of distributed database. One is homogeneous, the other one is heterogeneous distributed database. In homogeneous distributed database, the database in all our locations will have similar software. That is what this homogeneous distributed database. See here, all the databases are under Oracle database. Even though you have five different locations might use five different programming or operating system, and behind your operating system or a front end you are going to use the same database called Oracle. That is what homogeneous. So if all the different locations are using the same database setup, then you can say that it is homogeneous distributed database. And keep in remember that all the databases are connected to your network. So this is what the homogeneous distributed database. So here you have a DBMS software. So all the DBMS softwares are identical. That is why it is homogeneous distributed database. Next type of distributed database is heterogeneous. So here each and every site will use different database based on their requirement. So here see, site one is using hierarchical database, site two is using relational database, and site 3 is using network database, site 4 is using object oriented, and site 5 is also using it is using relational database. So each and every site is using different database based on their own requirement, and it has been connected to your network. That is what is heterogeneous database. Here it is not going to have an identical database software. The representation is over here. Here I have given mentioned it as DBS 1, 2, 3 and N. It means that each and every site is using different database. Site means different locations. That is what the meaning of site. So global user means it is a centralized part. The centralized part is divided into local users. So you can have any number of local users. All the local users, behind your local user, you're going to have your database software. Here your database software is of different. It is non-identical because it is using different databases. The advantages of distributed database is you can increase your reliability and availability of your database, and next you can have your control over your database, because if I'm going to use a database, I can hold the database in my own location and I can access it easily rather than storing it somewhere and accessing through network. Next is you can have your modular growth, and next is you can have a communication cost less, because the communication between front end and back end will be reduced, and you can have a faster response for certain queries because you are going to have your database on your location, and you have, as I mean that you are going to store your location in database in your location, it is not going to store all the data, you are going to store only the data which is required to you. The rest of the data will be stored in different locations. That is why we are getting faster responses for certain queries. So you have certain disadvantages. Disadvantages: if you have communication failure, you are going to face the challenges of your distributed database. Then if you're going to use different distributed database, there might be a software cost and complexity will be higher. Next, you can have processing overhead because you are going to communicate through network. So if you're going to communicate through network, you might lead to overhead. Next, you can have integrity problem. Next, as I told you, you might have slower response also, because certain queries might be stored in different locations. First, getting the data from different locations might be of slower response. These are all the certain disadvantages of your distributed database. So this is the architecture of your distributed database. See to that you have a site which hold your distributed database. Under that you can have your application programs. Then the third layer is of your local DBMS. Again, you can have n number of sites, and here you are going to have your site n. This is what your distributed architecture is, database architecture. Next, even here you are going to have a three-tier architecture like we have studied already in your first unit. So here in distributed database architecture also you have presentation layer and application layer and database layer. The process or the working of your presentation layer, application layer and database server are same. Like presentation layer is responsible for the user use of what the user is going to see, that will be seen in the presentation layer, and the application layer is responsible by the programmer, and the database server is responsible by the database administrator who is going to handle your database processing, like storing and retrieving your data from your database. Application layer, here you are going to have a programmer who is responsible for writing all the queries. So that is what I have explained in detail about your presentation layer, application layer and server. So here in distributed database, you will have a front end and back end. Front end portion will be used for interacting with the user. Back end portion is being handled by the database server who is going to get the data from the database. So here you are going to use a commit protocol, which you are going to study in next topic. So here a two-phase commit protocol is dealt, and it uses commit statement and recover statement. So what is the use of commit statement? Is it is used to save all the data into your database. Once it has been saved in your database, then you are going to have a commit statement. If you are going to use a recover statement, it means used that it can able to recover the data back from your failure. So here I'm going to tell about the transaction processing. So under transaction processing of your distributed database, I have an example over here. So cost of transferring the data from one network to the other network, because I told you already your database will be stored in different locations. If you are going to get the data from another location, you need to get the data through network. So for example, my employee table is one location and the department table is in another location. So in first location, my table has 10,000 rows and each row size is of about 100 bytes. And the total table size is of 10 power 6. Site 2 requires 100 rows and each size is of about 35 bytes and table size is of only 3,500 bytes. So I have two different locations. Each location have different tables. So my query is, for example, I need to retrieve the employee detail and name of the employee and the department name. So I need to retrieve each and every employee's name and department name. If so, what I need to do is, first I need to get the data from the employee table and I need to fetch the data from the department table, and that should be returned to my requesting site. So this is how you can process it. And this is how you need to process it for distributed database. Next, you need to know about what is concurrency, as we have studied already about this concurrency control in our centralized database. So if it is under distributed database, what all the problems that will happen is you need to deal with multiple copies of data item, because as I told you, you might have replication of data. If it has a replication of data, how you can able to have integrity. Next is if particular individual site has failed through, because of network, how you can handle it. And next, if you have a communication failure or if you have a distributed commit and deadlock problems, how you can be recovered. So these are the things we are going to study in next topic. And next, you have a, for all these things, you have a primary technique called primary site and primary copy technique. What is the use of primary site technique is, like, you can able to log a particular site which is being identified as a primary site, so that the particular site can able to manage the accessing between the other sites. Next is about the primary copy technique, where you can log only the particular data from each site. So it is not necessary to log the whole site for retrieving and managing, sorry, for retrieving and storing the data into your distributed database. So next topic, we'll see about commit protocol. Thank you.